Welcome to class. This series of videos I've made is for those of you who are taking first semester organic chemistry, which is a second year college chemistry course. So it is very important for us to review some key material from first year general chemistry. And to begin our review, we will start with defining the chemical bond. Why is this important? One of the focus of organic chemistry is to make new molecules. Right, so we're making and breaking bonds. So we need to be able to define what is this bond, what is this glue that's holding the atoms together. And in particular, of importance to us, we are going to look at what is a covalent bond. So the most basic definition of a covalent bond is when two atoms share electrons. For example, a hydrogen atom can exist as a particle with one proton in the center and one electron outside, and it has a certain energy level associated with it, right? So you can have many hydrogen atoms out there just existing by themselves as one proton and one electron. However, when they come together and share those two electrons between them, there is a certain type of stabilization that ensues. And that stabilization is what we describe as the bond. Let's take a look at that energy as a function of the distance between the two hydrogen atoms. So let's define this as internuclear distance. First, we can define them as infinitely far apart from each other. They do not have any positive or negative attractions towards each other. So we can label that as starting as zero here, when the hydrogens are just far away from each other. As they get closer to each other, there is a certain type of stabilization that's happening. And what is that stabilization? Well, remember, because inside the nucleus, there is a positive particle, the proton. And that positive particle is attracted to the electron of the other hydrogen. So as you come closer and closer, the positive and the negative are contributing to an overall net attractive force. Now, there is an optimum distance that these two atoms can be from each other until they start to have an adverse effect. That adverse effect is caused by the two positively charged protons repelling one another and the two negatively charged electrons repelling one another. That repulsive force begins to overwhelm the attractive force, increasing the energy. So it's basically a balance between the attractive and repulsive force. So at that optimum distance where there's the most stabilized energy, we determine that to be the distance in the x-axis is then defined as the bond length. And the energy is the bond dissociation energy. In the case of hydrogen, the bond length is 0.74 angstroms. And remember, an angstrom is 1 times 10 to negative 10th power of meters. And for hydrogen, the bond dissociation energy is negative 436 kilojoules per mole. So now that we have the idea that the sharing of electron is what defined a bond, and we know there are more complicated bonds than just a hydrogen bond, we need a simple way to represent this sharing of electrons.
We will rely on what is known as the Lewis structure or the Lewis dot structure. The Lewis structure emphasizes valence electrons. Remember, valence electrons are those electrons on the outermost shell of an atom. We will use two dots to represent a lone pair and a line to represent two electrons that are shared between two atoms.
Let's review how to count the valence electrons of an atom based on its position on the periodic table. And so in the first column known as 1A, we have hydrogen. In the fourth column, we have carbon. In the fifth A column, we have nitrogen and phosphorus. 6A, we got oxygen and sulfur. 7A, we have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine. Those atoms are important in organic chemistry, so we will focus on them for now and leaving the rest of the periodic table out. So remember that if you are in column 7A, you have then 7 valence electrons. If you are in column 6A, you would have 6 valence electrons. So going back to Lewis structure, we can represent the valence electrons on these atoms as a single dot. For hydrogen, we would signify it as an H with a dot next to it. For carbon, it has four. It doesn't matter where you put these dots, as long as you have four dots around carbon. For nitrogen, it would be five dots. For oxygen, it would be six dots. And for fluorine, then seven dots. So these are some examples of the Lewis dot structures for the individual atoms. Now it turns out when these atoms bond and share electrons, the driving force behind it is that they want to have the electron configuration of a noble gas. So taking a look at fluorine here, fluorine is right next to neon. So neon has eight electrons in its valence shell. So in order to be like neon, fluorine must gain one electron, right? So in order to gain one electron, how do you do that? You would have to bond. You would have to share your electron from another atom. So it turns out, since fluorine needs one more electron, it will bond one more time. Because of that, we call fluorine to be monovalent. It only makes one more bond. With that pattern, let's go to oxygen. How many more electrons does it need to be like neon? It has six now, neon has eight, so it would need two more electrons. Because it needs two more electrons, it's going to bond twice. So we call this divalent. And so you see the pattern here. Nitrogen is five valence electrons, so it's gonna bond three times, so it's gonna be trivalent. Carbon, four electrons, four more to be like neon, so it's gonna be tetravalent. So all of these patterns of bonding is alluding to a rule known as the octet rule. And the octet rule simply states that when you are drawing the Lewis dot structure, make sure your atom has eight electrons around it. Oct meaning eight. Now there is one exception to this, which is hydrogen. So hydrogen, it turns out, the closest noble gas element to it is helium. And helium only has two valence electrons because it's in that first shell. So instead of going for the octet rule, just for hydrogen, we have another rule called the duet rule. Hydrogens need only two valence electrons to be happy. It will only form one more bond. So hydrogen is also called monovalent.
So now let's see how we can draw a Lewis structure for an entire molecule, not just an atom. There's a simple guideline that we can use to help us draw correct Lewis structures.
The first is to count the total number of valence electrons in that molecule. The second is to determine the connectivity of the atoms in that molecule. Essentially, which atom is in the center, which atom is on the outside. Third, you connect the atoms with a line representing the bonds. Then you complete the octet by drawing dots around the individual atoms. Once you are done with all your electrons, make sure that all of your atoms do have a complete octet. If it doesn't, then you will have to do the fourth step, which is to shift the electrons around to complete the octet. So let's take a look at an example. Let's say we have the molecule CH2O. So in the first step, we have to count the total valence electrons. Again, counting valence electrons is relying on the periodic table for each atom. So carbon would be four valence electrons, hydrogen one, oxygen six. So four plus two plus six is 12 electrons. You potentially will have an extra complication in this first step if you have a positive or negative molecule. In this case, ours is neutral, so we do not have to do anything extra. But for example, if you had let's say this somehow was a negatively charged molecule, because it is negative, that means it has an extra electron making the overall molecule negative, right? So then you would just have to add one more electron, making it 13 electron as your total valence count. However, if it was a positively charged molecule, then it means that you have to take away one electron, right? Because electrons are negative. So if you take one electron away, it would be positive overall. So in that case, you would do a minus one electron, giving you a total of 11 valence electrons. In this case, we do not have that, so we don't have to worry about that. So it's a straightforward counting here of 12 valence electrons. Step 2, we have to determine the connectivity. So if the connectivity is not given to you, then you have to try your best to determine which atom is the central atom. And the rule is that you want to have the least electronegative atom in the center. Remember, electronegativity means how hungry, quote unquote, how hungry it is for electrons. So if you're in the center, if you're very electronegative, you don't want to share so much. So you're not going to be happy. So you want an atom that is willing to share to be in its center. So that's one good way to think about that. So do you remember the trends of electronegativity? Going from left to right on a periodic table, will it increase or decrease? Electronegativity increases from left to right. We're really only looking here at carbon and oxygen, because hydrogen, since it can only bond once, it cannot be in the center. So we're really a competition between carbon and oxygen. So carbon is to the left of oxygen, right? So that means carbon is less electronegative. So carbon is going to be your central atom. All right, number 3. Now we're just going to connect the central atom with all the other atoms, and then whatever's left over of valence electrons, we will sprinkle it around the outside atoms first to try to complete their octet. In this case, we have two hydrogens, so I'm going to go ahead and connect it on both sides, and then connect the oxygen on the top. Again, Lewis structures doesn't tell you the exact orientation of the atoms or the shape of this molecule, so you can put the connection however you want. You can put it like this, or you could have done it like this. It doesn't matter. A Lewis structure, it just talks about the connection and where electrons are, not the actual shape of the molecule. So far we've used 3 lines, and each line represents 2 electrons, right? So 2 times 3, that's 6 electrons used. 12 minus 6 electrons used, it means we have 6 electrons left. Remember, in a Lewis structure, we cannot draw more valence electrons than we have. So always make sure to count that. So 6 valence electrons, so we have oxygen that needs an octet. So we'll go ahead and give all 6 electrons to oxygen. Oxygen now has 8 electrons. So good. Let's move on to step 4. Step 4 is to make sure that all atoms either have a duet if it's hydrogen, or an octet if it's any other atoms. So it turns out, what you notice here is that carbon is not very happy. It does not yet have an octet. It has only 6 electrons, right? So in step 4, it's saying to shift electrons around to complete the octet. So shifting electrons around means you're going to share it. So carbon needs more electrons. It looks around. Who can have electrons to share? In this case, it's oxygen. Oxygen has these electrons all by itself, but it can move it down and between it and carbon to share these electrons, like so. Remember, if a pair of electrons is shared between two atoms, we can simply call that a bond, so we can represent that as a line, not as two dots anymore. Notice how when you shift these electrons down, oxygen still has 8 electrons, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So it still has 8 electrons, it just shared its electron, it didn't lose its electrons. And at the same time, carbon has 8 electrons, 4 from its top and 4 more from its sides, giving it a total of 8 valence electrons. So everybody is happy, that means we have a good structure. Some more vocabulary before we move on here are the two types of pairs of electrons that we're talking about. Anytime you have a pair of electrons that resides completely on a single atom, we call those lone pairs. Whereas when you have an electron pair that is shared between two atoms, we call those bonding pair. Let's do another example, C2H6O. If given a molecule with multiple central atoms, it is possible that this formula can have multiple Lewis structures and representing different molecules. So for example, in this case, it could represent this molecule, an alcohol, or it could represent this other molecule, an ether. Both of these, if you take the time to count, the number of carbons, hydrogens, and oxygens are identical to each other, and they are both valid Lewis structures. So it turns out this is very common. And so these two molecules are called constitutional isomers. Many times we can represent these molecules in what's known as a condensed structural formula. In order to give more information to the simple chemical formula, to help the reader know the connection, we often use a condensed structural formula. For example, this is a very common unit, 3 hydrogens to 1 carbon. And this is another common unit, 2 hydrogens to 1 carbon. We can abbreviate this by writing CH3, CH2, and then OH to represent the alcohol isomer. And then on the right-hand side, the ether, we notice that there are 2 CH3s. We can write this more definitively as CH3OCH3, or because the CH3 is a repeating unit, we could have written it as O with a CH3 in a parenthesis subscript of 2. So if we were given this formula and this formula, then we could draw the exact Lewis structure. If we're just given a more vague, generic chemical formula, we cannot.
And lastly, we will talk about formal charges. Formal charges is a way of bookkeeping for us to indicate more or less if an atom has more or less electron density than it typically has.
So for example, recall back when we said oxygen was a divalent atom, meaning it will bond to 2 more things only, right? So for example, so this is water, H2O. However, there's another molecule, H3O. So it has an extra bond to it. Because it has an extra bond, that lone pair of electrons that used to belong to oxygen now has to share with another hydrogen. So this oxygen, we can say, is now positive because it's losing some of that its own electrons. Now it has to share, right? So it's losing electrons, so it's more positive. So that formal charge, we say, is a +1 on oxygen. So we say positive and we circle it next to the oxygen. Now more systematically, how to calculate that, there's a formula for it. And the formula is basically the group number minus the number of electrons it has. And electrons here is when you have a lone pair electron that represents 2, and when you have a bond, it also represents just 1 electron. So for example, oxygen has the group number is 6, right? How many electrons does it have? It has 1, 2, and then 3, 4, 5. Remember, we only count 1 of the electrons in the bonding pair because we imagine that the other electron belongs to hydrogen. It only really, quote unquote, owns 5 electrons. So 6 minus 5 is 1. Because of that, we say there's a formal charge of +1 on that oxygen. Let's do another example. How about this one? Does this oxygen also seem kind of off? It has only 1 bond, right? Because it has only 1 bond, there are more electrons that owned by itself and not being shared. So we would imagine that this oxygen atom is negatively charged. It has more electrons than it usually does. So to indicate that, we put a negative sign on that oxygen. So again, we can calculate this more formally. Oxygen is on a 6th column, so it starts out with 6. How many electrons does it, quote unquote, own? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? So 6 minus 7 is -1. That's why it has a negative charge there. We write this as OH minus. Going back to our middle case here, H3O, actually it's H3O plus. Okay, so that's a little bit about formal charges.